Hey everybody, welcome to Sarcasmus Podcast, where Tom Nook is a thief as much as Camilla isn't real. This is the first episode of Who Wore It Better, where we seek to discuss what elements shine out of any two games the most. I'm your host, Aiden Lopez, and I'm joined by Ridley of Sarcasmus. How are you, Ridley?
I'm good, how are you?
Really good. So this is an idea that's been long coming, and we've been wanting to do this one for a while. And it kind of spawned out of times when we were sort of bored on Destiny, I guess you would say. We ran out of conversation material, and then we came up with this sort of method to keep the conversation going, and we would generally compare two things within games. So let's just say, you know, the use of a spin dash either in Sonic or like Billy Hatcher or something stupid like that, and we would say who wore it better, and we would discuss based upon that. I've got four notes of mention that Ridley hasn't heard yet, but three that we're both very familiar with, so we're gonna start out with the familiar, and then we're gonna go into the four things that I wrote. So let's get started. So, time powers. Who wore it better? Braid or Prince of Persia?
Well, I don't have a lot of experience with Braid. I did recently watch you play through all of it.
Yes.
I have much more experience with Prince of Persia, but I'm gonna say Braid has better time powers, because Prince of Persia, as far as I remember, all you could really do was, like, go back in time.
Yeah.
But Braid, you do the same thing, but Braid, it affects the enemies. The enemies can respawn when you reverse time.
That's right, yeah.
Obstacles can just replace themselves. Mm-hmm. Key items that you need to finish the game, if you pick them up and rewind right away, you drop them. It makes for much more entertaining time use.
I would say so, and I think, I mean, I agree. It's just that in terms of exposure, I was exposed to Prince of Persia first.
Well, yeah, but it also came out first.
Yeah, that's true. I think Braid probably wouldn't have been a thing if Prince of Persia wasn't a thing already. I think Prince of Persia might have laid the groundwork for what Braid was. But at the same time, I have to agree that Braid kind of took the idea, ran with it, and then made it 1,000 times better. However, I think that Prince of Persia had its own things that made it shine, so it had different power-ups in it that were not time-related, I guess. So we can't really talk about that here because that's not really relevant, but in terms of what the main character could do, it wasn't just rewind time in Prince of Persia. So I think that would make it like a completely separate topic altogether, but in terms of just time, Braid probably wins because of variety and variety alone.
Yeah, no, it really breaks apart the game through every single level, which is really nice. And they're all time-based, so it's great.
Yeah. Agreement?
Yeah, agreed. Braid wins.
Cool. Next up, who wore it better? Snarky dialogue. Now, we both played the Portal games, and both seen Stanley Parable, and we've both seen some of the Behemoth games, such as Battle Block, which we recently went through in minor detail. Snarky dialogue. I think GLaDOS is probably one of the best sarcastic characters out there, but that wasn't like the point of her character. In terms of what it did for the game, it made it a whole lot better, especially in the first game where you had no one else to hear besides GLaDOS's voice. In Portal 2, I think that was probably the best, because then you had Wheatley, and then you, along with GLaDOS, and then Cave Johnson, which are just, those three voice actors working together was just a beautiful match made in heaven for that game. Stanley Parable, like the first Portal game, and why that I think Portal 2 was so much better, is that Stanley Parable really only has one voice actor throughout the entire game, making like snarky quips here and there, and it works really well with the game. The snark and the sarcastic nature of everything is actually the point of the game, because you're supposed to pretty much decide whether you want to defy or follow closely with what the narrator tells you to do. Now, in terms of Behemoth, I haven't been following Stamper for an incredibly long time, but that's who the narrator is, if you've heard of him. He's a Newgrounds guy. I think his rendition, I want to say, in Battle Block Theater is probably, I mean, it made me laugh out loud several times, and I can hear it over and over and over again and continue to laugh, but it's not really that big of a deal to the game as much. Like, I think the game would be more empty without it, I think, in terms of how it feels and atmosphere-wise, but in terms of gameplay, it doesn't really, like...
It doesn't add anything.
With Stanley Parable, that was the point. With Portal 2, it was like they would give you, they would say certain things about your environment that would kind of clue you in lore-wise to what's going on. And Stamper kind of just sort of narrates the story in the cutscenes, and that's where he shines the most. During the game, in fact, I think it's probably the worst because the gameplay noises actually...
He just kind of says generic stuff.
Yeah, he says generic stuff, and then the gameplay noises overpower his voice, so he's really quiet during the game. Like, I'm sure he's incredibly hilarious in what he says, but I can only hear, like, a couple of choice things, like when he screams or whatever.
Yeah.
But yeah, I want to say, unfortunately, even though I like Battle Block Theater, and I want to say I love Battle Block Theater, especially because of its quirkiness, I want to say that that goes last on the list for me. Stanley Parable goes second, and then Portal 2 goes first, because of just the amount of voice acting there was in that game, and the variety, and then the banter between those two characters. Like, complete 100% spoiler alert, you've been warned. I don't know who hasn't played through Portal 2 by now, but in terms of Carolyn and Cave Johnson and their banter between one another, and then having Gladys, like, now this is getting into completely separate territory, but God, oh my God, like, Portal 2 is just so darn good. I can't just talk about its snarkiness because that seems like it's a hindrance, but in terms of that, even, I think that they have three snarky characters in one game. It's Wheatley, it's Gladys, and then it's Cave Johnson, who, by the way, is also the same guy who plays J. Jonah Jameson in Spider-Man, the original Spider-Man.
Really?
Yeah. He's great. He's absolutely fantastic. So, anyway, what do you think?
I disagree with you.
Oh, really?
I think... I agree with you that Battle Block Theater is at the end.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that Stanley Parable is better.
Okay.
At snarkiness. Mainly because when you were describing it, you made a perfect point about how Portal will... Their snark will kind of... talk about the backstory or talk about the environments or
right.
stuff like that. But Stanley Parable, it seems much more personally aimed at you. When we were playing it together, when the narrator would talk badly about the player, we both kind of had this moment. It hurt us. It actually hurt our feelings. It made us feel bad.
And made us react based off that.
It determined or not whether we obeyed his advice or would completely ignore
it.
So I personally think that Stanley Parable is a better snark. I love Portal, and I've been dying to play a co-op with you for the longest time. But
which we need to do probably on stream, which would be great.
I still think Stanley Parable has better snark.
All right, fair enough.
That and the vast different options in that game.
Like, yeah, there's not one line to go through.
Yeah, you play Portal like six times, you know what's going to be said, but you play Stanley Parable six times, you have no idea what's
you're
going to
be surprised.
I think that's the best one.
Yeah, sure, absolutely. Yeah, in terms of dialogue, yeah, you're kind of swaying my opinion, honestly, but no, I'm going to stay firm on Portal 2 on this one. But yeah, so since there's an agreement, why don't you guys talk about it in the comments, and then we'll sort of reply based on what you guys say. But in any case, so we have one last one that's kind of it's a little silly, but the ones that I have planned are going to sort of even that out a little bit. So we have biggest badass side character, Bridget Johnson from the Halo series, or Lord Saladin from Destiny. Since I did last one, you go ahead and start this one off.
I don't remember a lot about Halo. I have played all of them.
Yeah.
I haven't finished two yet. Mm-hmm. Mainly because the Master Chief Collection is a disaster. I'm going to say Saladin because his lore is a lot more interesting to me. Mm. From what I understand, Sergeant Johnson does some really cool stuff.
He does.
But Saladin apparently is the last of his kind who goes out every single night by himself with a legit pack of wolves and fights Siva-infested Fallen.
That's right.
With a flaming axe. And he does this alone every single night.
That,
that is the definition of a badass. You can't sway me from that.
I'm incredibly biased because I played the Halo games to no end, and I've lived with Sergeant Johnson in all the Halo games up until his, spoiler alert, eventual death in Halo 3. Again, who the hell hasn't played Halo 3 yet? In Halo 1, he sort of solidifies himself as kind of a side character because I can't remember quite accurately whether or not this is the case, but I don't think he was even named in Halo 1. I know he was a character for sure, because at the end, obviously, we you know, we get this little, like, if you beat the legendary version of the game, then it's just, like, at the very end, you get Johnson holding an elite next to him as he sees, like, the maw explode and go up in flames. It's just, like, it's beautiful. And apparently Johnson dies in Halo 1, but then he resurrects in the preceding games. And that can only be chalked up, of course, to the fact that they expected Halo 1 to be the last one. But I digress. Point is that apparently Sergeant Johnson cheated death in Halo 1. Because he was really supposed to die. It's really not incredibly detailed as to how exactly he did that. I think maybe one of the books goes into that. But we don't read books here at Sarcasmus. We just play games. No, in all seriousness, though, I want to say Sergeant Johnson has built up quite a record with me. And that's the main reason why I have to go with him, is because he has a history with me in terms of, you know, his legacy. Now, Salad has just that one thing. You know, that being said, that one thing is amazing, and he's an Iron Lord, and the weapon that he wields is completely nonsensical, but it's badass regardless. And the wolves, I don't understand, just alien world, but wolves? Cool. I mean, it's Earth, obviously, but in terms of just, like, you know, you'd think they'd go for something a little bit more, like, fitting with the fantasy, like, vibe that Destiny gives off, like maybe some weird alien that he tamed or something
like
that.
Just like an alien dragon.
Yeah, but it's straight up wolves, which is cool.
That's what's cool about it.
Yeah, that I think that makes it cool, but...
He gets a pack of wolves to just accept him, and they fight for him.
I think another cool thing about Saladin, obviously, is that he was the year one and two sort of how would you say, the NPC that ran the Iron Banner. And as everyone who's played Destiny understands, that the Iron Banner is no joke. If you're going in to expect a particularly casual experience, Iron Banner isn't really for that. Iron Banner weeds out the weak, not like Trials does, of course.
No, Trials is a different level entirely.
Yes, and whoever runs that, being the original Warlock Osiris, he's not even around, he's such a badass, so he's not even, we can't talk about him as much. But in terms of Saladin versus Johnson, I have to go with Johnson just mainly based off of his record. Although I agree with all the sentiments regarding Saladin. But yeah, if you have any additional things to add to that.
No, I'll agree with you that Saladin is only a badass for that one, like,
yeah,
thing, and that Johnson has had more of an effect. But I've known them both for about the same time in all reality, because or at least the same amount of time.
Sure.
I'm still going to have to go with Saladin, because all I could picture from Johnson that I remember is just Cigar Man.
Yeah, and I think my opinion might be swayed in subsequent titles, because if they expand more on Saladin and give him more of, like, a legacy, and they give him, and for those of you that are screaming, you know, he does have a legacy, it's just like, I know he has a legacy, but in terms of Grimoire and the lore, and it's
can
just
we
like,
see it?
It's it's not something that we can, like, grasp. It's not as tangible, because in the cutscenes of the Rise of Iron, we see his badassery just embodied. It's there. It's tangible. We can see it. In terms of in the game, I think so far Saladin needs more time in the spotlight, I think. I think he needs, in Destiny 2, whenever the hell that's coming, they need to make Saladin a prime character, as well as Shax, because for as long as Shax has been running the Crucible, we've known nothing about him in-game whatsoever, and apparently he has this incredible feud with Saladin that's only briefly mentioned in the context of, like, the matchmaking banter that they have, or when Shax has, when he says, like, oh, would you rather Lord Saladin be overseeing these matches or something like that? I think that would be cool too, and then maybe Shax would step up to be a bigger badass or something. But in terms of solely win Destiny, Saladin's the biggest badass out of them all. Queen's, you know, not nowhere right now, so it's not like she can step up to that plate. But yeah, in any case, so cool. In terms of this discussion, I'd call it a disagreement, for the most part, at least in its end result. For now, I want to say I'd probably be swayed sooner than later in terms of what kind of content they expect to release. But yeah, again, you guys, just tell us what you think in the comments, and we'll consider your opinions we won't hate you too much if you disagree with us. So go ahead and do that. I think it's just about time for me to segue this over to the secret topics that I have.
Oh, I'm so excited.
First, we have both games that we have played together, and one where I have fonder memories over the other, admittedly, even though I like one game more than the other. I think you're in the same boat as me. So, who wore it better? Vehicles, Halo, or Battlefield?
Oh, man. I have amazing experiences with you playing Battlefield. Vehicles were just that. In Halo, they were amazing.
Yeah, they...
I can never get the names right for them. But they're amazing in Halo. Mm. I love them.
I think Battlefield... Because I really didn't narrow it down here, and I think I should have, but in terms of how they control in Battlefield, I think they're a whole lot more nuanced, and you kind of have to... There's a slight learning curve to how you use certain vehicles in Battlefield, whereas in Halo, you just jump in. It's pretty much just a plug and play.
It's just, if you can use analog, you're good.
Yeah, pretty much. If you can use analog and the left trigger sometimes, if you want to splatter somebody, there you go. In terms of how fun they are to use...
Halo.
Like,
it's still
down.
Halo.
Yeah, hands down. Because I think part of the thing that makes Battlefield slightly rage-inducing when it comes to the vehicles is that you find, I got a jet, finally, after, you know, getting X amount of kills or whatever, you know. Or, someone hasn't stolen the jet. It's finally ready for me to use. So I think when you finally go in that jet, you know, after waiting for so long, in front of a queue of players that have been waiting to use the jet, and you snag it for yourself.
And before you even get off the ground, you just blow up.
Exactly. Exactly. Or if you manage to get off the ground, you just nosedive or something like that. Like, the learning curve for Battlefield can be kind of like...
Because you're a scrub. And you have no right to play such games.
I think Halo has also a really interesting variety, too. So you have, like, warthogs, you got... The Ghosts, you got the Banshees, you got the Falcon, and Halo Reach.
There's a lot more variety other than just, like, a helicopter that seats one person.
And then
here's a helicopter with two people.
Yeah, yeah. And I think the Halo vehicles have sort of solidified themselves as being more iconic.
Yes.
Because you can spot a Warthog, you can spot a Scorpion, you can spot a Ghost. In Battlefield, it's just like, the freaking AC-76270. It's just like, yeah,
what?
That thing. It's like, yeah, no, by the way, sorry if I've terribly triggered you Battlefield fans out there, but...
But we're scrubs.
But we're scrubs.
And we understand that we have no right to play your Battlefield. And we never will again, don't worry.
After Hardline, that was it. They lost me. But yeah, so, all right, cool. Halo, hands down, in terms of who wore vehicles better.
Yeah.
Absolutely.
That was a very easy one.
Yeah, that was a pretty easy one,
I think. They get harder.
This one may be a little bit more of a conversation point. We might actually, we might find ourselves within this podcast in terms of the opinions that we have, the opinions. Cell shaded. Who wore cell shaded better? Wind Waker or Gravity Rush?
Oh no, that's hard.
Yeah,
I wasn't expecting that.
Yeah, that's.
I don't
want
to play this game anymore. I don't want one to lose, but I think I'm gonna surprise you. I'm gonna pick Gravity Rush.
Okay, why?
The world is just so beautifully put together and vibrant. Obviously, the release gap between the two is a huge note.
Yes. Yes, but I think Wind Waker HD is more comparable to Gravity Rush 2, if anything, just in terms of graphical fidelity.
Yes.
They both look equally as beautiful.
They're both beautiful, but Wind Waker was still blue.
True.
And there was a reason for that, and I understand there was a reason for that, and I still love it. It's still one of my favorite ones.
Mm-hmm.
But the variety that Gravity Rush 1 and 2 can just give in a world is so beautiful. Like, the first one, we've even acknowledged the fact that it's such an ugly world.
It is.
But it's so gorgeous to look at.
Yeah, there's a lot of on-screen elements in terms of Gravity Rush 1 and 2. There's like... Well, and you know what? That's one of the reasons why I thought Gravity Rush 1 actually might be a little worse than Wind Waker originally, because I think that just the amount of stuff that just like bombarded you at the same time in Gravity Rush 1 was...
Gravity Rush 1, though, was on the Vita at first.
Oh, that's true. That's
which
true. Yeah.
Made it look very grainy.
Yeah.
And they kept that grainy look for the PS4 version for some reason. It still has that kind of grainy filter over it.
Yeah.
But 2 really just clears the entire screen up and all the environments, and they all look so beautiful.
Yeah, and another thing is that, like, when there is a lot of on-screen elements, like, sort of in 2, they do the graphics are just so good that it doesn't even matter, because, like, for example, the first area in, what's it called, Jirga Paralau or something? The market district, where you, like, you just walk off the plane.
Yeah.
Seeing all those, like, booths and, like, the foods, like, the
I'm gonna be completely honest with you, and I very rarely do this in any video game.
Yeah, yeah.
Gravity Rush 2, when I got to the market,
yeah,
I didn't run, I just walked and observed and... It took everything in.
Yeah.
It was gorgeous.
Yeah, yeah. No, and I think...
It's like I told you earlier, it's a game that actually makes me want to buy a PlayStation 4 Pro and a 4K TV.
Yeah, yeah.
It really makes me want to do that.
Oh, it's gorgeous. Yeah, no, and I mean, you really can never go wrong with cel-shaded. I mean, except for the times when you can.
Which is a lot.
Which is a lot.
Surprisingly.
Surprisingly, yeah. You can mess that up. But I think in terms of the most popular cel-shaded games out there, like Borderlands or whatever...
That's a hideous looking cel shade.
Yeah, I think I
get that that's the style, but like that's still nothing to like.
See, here's the thing.
Gorgeous.
Borderlands was going for kind of a sketchy sort of feel, and then Gravity Rush is basically imitating a comic.
Yes.
And it does it way better.
Perfect.
It does it perfectly. Gravity Rush 2 blew me out of the water, man. That was just amazing. That was beautiful. And I think when I first played Wind Waker, I mean, for the time, I thought it was really good. You know, the first Wind Waker.
Yeah.
And then they did it again with Wind Waker HD, where I'm just like, yeah, that game already looks good, so I don't really think it needs an HD remaster. Then they HD remaster it, and it's like, holy crap, you guys actually surprised me a second time with the same game in terms of graphical fidelity. Mind you, the changes that they made were more ambient changes, so they have like this... They have like brighter sun rays, and they have like just like the lighting is so much more vibrant, and the colors, I think the contrast
There's a huge difference between the GameCube version.
Yeah, there's a huge difference, but I don't think how nice it looks in the HD remaster has anything to do with the cel shadedness of it. I think they improve the lighting and they improve like a lot of things like the color, but in terms of like the cel shadedness of it.
Yeah.
And you know, now that you mention it, in terms of detail and how they utilize a cel-shaded graphics engine, or however it is that you want to describe it, I think in terms of how detailed it is, I want to say Gravity Rush 2 wins by a mile. Because really, they didn't even update the polygons in Wind Waker HD. They're actually not incredibly detailed models. The thing that makes it look incredibly good is obviously the cartoony aspect of it. In Gravity Rush 2, they struck this excellent balance between making it like minimalist while making it just detailed enough for you to say, wow, this is beautiful.
Yes.
So, you know what? I thought I was going to say Wind Waker at the beginning of this. I honestly thought I was going to say Wind Waker, but I have to go with Gravity Rush 2.
Yes. So, Gravity Rush 2 wins.
Yes, absolutely.
And just for people who are thinking we're saying horrible things about Wind Waker, we adore Wind Waker.
Oh, yeah. We love Wind Waker.
Shut up.
So, this next one is going to be... Whew, this is a kicker. Who wore it better? Fan base, FNAF or Undertale? Five Nights at Freddy's.
We're gonna make a lot of people angry with this one, aren't we?
Yes, we are.
I thought the worst it was getting was so, the Wind Waker not beating Gravity Rush, and now you just bring that out.
So I should clarify, though. I should clarify.
Are you talking about which is more toxic?
No. Yeah, I should clarify. So because this is who wore it better. Which fan base is actually less toxic? So which one's more tolerable, at least from our experience? Mind you guys, okay, let's get this out of the way right now. Neither me nor Ridley have ever completed either Undertale or any Five Nights at Freddy's game. Ever. Okay, neither of us. But we have legitimate exposure to the fan base.
Yes.
Through multiple mediums.
So we have more of a right to talk about the fan base than the games, which is fine.
Yeah, no, we have absolutely no opinions on the games whatsoever. From what I've played of Undertale and what Ridley's played of Undertale, we actually like it because it's a legitimately good game, but the problem...
But there's a video we're making right now that's going to talk about that in detail.
Yeah, we won't get too much into that, but just so you guys know... This is not us bashing the game. This is us talking about, you know, communities that rally behind these games and such. So,
and we understand that when I was making the little joke about toxicity, I understand that toxic communities are so much smaller than the actual fan bases.
Oh, sure. Yeah.
So,
yeah, that, and it's not, you're not going to find a toxic fan base just in Five Nights at Freddy's and Undertale. That's everywhere.
Yes. Oh, they're everywhere.
So, yeah, in any case, though, because those seem to be just the ones in the sky right now.
The most infamous ones right now.
Yeah, yeah.
I'm going to say Undertale.
Okay.
Undertale, I've had people actually praise the game to me and try to get me to play it.
Okay.
More than I've heard people try to sell me on Five Nights at Freddy's.
Okay. I have kind of a odd... counter, because I kind of disagree, actually. Not because I don't think that there are not people like that, because I'm sure there are, but in terms of which one I think is less toxic, and this is a really, really terrible example.
I know you're going to go into Miiverse. You're going to go into the conversation about Miiverse.
Yeah, so I've seen the worst of the worst. We've seen the worst of the worst.
Well, my thing is also that every time I walk into any GameStop, there's like a wall of Five Nights at Freddy's merchandise.
Sure, yeah.
And I'm quite frankly kind of tired of seeing it.
Yeah, yeah. And then that guy just kind of farts out Five Nights at Freddy's games. Like, he just keeps making them. And then he says, no, this is the last one. And then he makes another one.
No, it's a movie deal.
No, but I think in terms of the Undertale fan base was so much louder than the Five Nights at Freddy's. Like, I hardly...
The negative portion of both of them are really loud, but if you can hack your way through all the disgusting toxic people that are there, the majority fan base is really great, and they make really good art.
Yeah,
and
they do.
They constantly praise the games, and it's something that I can respect more than just...
Staying quiet.
Than just, yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. Well, yeah, I think...
And I've even had a conversation with... This is just one person. This is just... I don't know if there's other people who will do this.
Mm.
But I've had one of my friends who actually got me into starting up Undertale.
Right.
And he was saying, yeah, I know a lot of this community is really toxic.
Mm.
But you have to take it from someone who wants people to actually play the game and love it.
That's incredibly respectable, yeah. And... You know what? I think it's just a mere fact that I haven't heard something like that from Five Nights at Freddy's.
Yeah.
Because really, think about the demographic that we're talking about. For Five Nights at Freddy's, it's sort of the, like, you know, I want to say it's sort of like it's a horror for younger audiences.
Most definitely.
Like, I want to say that's the demographic that it reached, and especially with who's aggregating and circulating the I mean,
absolutely.
Like, thinking about Markiplier and then, you know, the, just...
We're not talking about that right now.
The different communities that form based upon who is actually aggregating the content and the gameplay, and it's just like, yeah, you can kind of clearly see just at a glance who enjoys what in terms of demographic. And I think Undertale is a whole lot more of a mixed crowd than Five Nights at Freddy's is. And I think that's what probably might give it a leg up, is because you have a lot of immaturity with Five Nights at Freddy's, and you kind of have a more...
Some people who don't really have exposure to other horror games.
Yeah.
Because it's so easy to access Five Nights at Freddy's.
Right.
So...
Right. I felt like the group that transitioned from Slender was the same group that arrived at Five Nights at Freddy's.
Yes.
And not saying, of course, that original craze was, you know, completely meaningless, because I'm sure that the game in and of itself had some value to begin with, but I think with the overhyped and exaggerated expressions of whoever would play it on YouTube kind of really put a damper on it, and it just simply wasn't scary anymore. Yeah. I think maybe the novelty wore off after like the first couple weeks of it going viral. But in terms of fan bases, yeah, you know what? I think you've swayed me. I have to agree.
That's an interesting idea that I'd like to make too, is whatever happened to horror games? Because horror games are in this weird spot right now.
Yeah, they are, like, admittedly. Yeah, no, I think, yeah, I should write that down, actually. It's a pretty good idea for a next discussion.
Yes!
So we will do that. What happened to horror?
Expect that in 6 months.
Not really, but pretty much. So let's move on to the final discussion point here.
I'm so excited to see what this is.
Who wore it better? Difficulty, Dark Souls, or the raids in Destiny?
They're difficult for different reasons, though.
They are, but no, that's not specified.
Okay, specify, because it could go either way.
Well, in terms of...
Because if you're talking about which is more cryptic, Destiny.
Well, sure. I want to say difficult in terms of the amount of times you die.
Okay.
Is the barometer we're looking at.
Well, that can really be added to a lot of games.
Right, yeah.
Even classic ones. Like,
oh, absolutely.
If you want to count times you died, classic ones win.
Sure. Yeah. Yeah, absolutely.
If you're going to talk about, which is more balanced difficulty or which is more...
I want to say...
Which has more of a reward for your... defeating an over...
Since this is who wore it better, I want to say that in terms of difficulty, we want to talk about which one was harder. Which
now,
one
let me
you
add,
died
Let
more.
Me add something to that.
Sure.
Because I think this will lead to an interesting conversation, because I know for a fact we both have different opinions on this.
Yes.
Which probably. One has a more rewarding feeling after you beat a difficult part?
Okay.
Which one does that better?
Right. Yeah, that's good. That's
you can
good.
Have the floor.
Okay, cool. So, oh, wow. Okay. You know what? I want to say, having actually played all of the raids, I want to say I feel the experience is a whole lot more rewarding in Destiny than it is in Dark Souls. Because for Dark Souls, once you, let's say, beat a boss that you've been trying to beat for ages, there's going to be two things you're going to get. That's the Lord's Soul of whatever boss you got, a soul that helps you craft like a freaking amazing weapon later with additional materials, and like 10 to 12,000 souls.
I'm not talking about what you earn, because that's just randomized. That's luck.
Okay.
I'm talking about having a lot of difficulty with this boss, and then when you finally get that health to zero...
And
you just go like, yes, that rewarding feeling.
Okay. All right.
Because if we're talking about rewards, it's obviously going to be Destiny because you have all the different weapons and armor types that you can get randomized.
Okay. So, well, yeah, then in terms of that, I still want to stay in Destiny then.
Okay.
Because I've had many experience with wiping and wiping and wiping and wiping. And that is perhaps... the most amount of wiping that I've ever had to do in a video game that is multiplayer focused. I can just imagine someone skipping to this part of the podcast and just hearing me say in repetition, wiping and wiping and wiping, and wondering where the hell our conversation got to. But yeah, so yeah, I want to say in terms of... Because, you know, also you kind of form a fellowship with the people that you're playing with and with raids, and I think that sort of like, that solidifies. I mean, the moment we beat Oryx was just...
Yes.
Seeing that guy just float off.
Yes.
Yeah, that was
great.
There
were multiple emotions for me with that part. And I will get to that when it's my turn.
Okay. Well, I actually, you know what? I think that pretty much concludes my opinion, actually, but with one, I think one additional thing. I think, moving aside, you know, how rewarding it feels in terms of difficulty and which one is harder, I think I might have to, I'm kind of on the fence about that one, because as much as I've wiped...
I might pull you over.
Okay, as much as I've wiped in Destiny raids with a fire team, I want to say the amount of times where I've decided to quit I have to give that to Dark Souls. But at the same time, Destiny made me feel dead inside when we wouldn't win, because everyone was just simultaneously on this disappointed...
Yes.
So, you know, it goes either way for me.
I've wanted to rage quit way more in Destiny than I've wanted to do in Dark Souls. Mm. And I love Dark Souls. Mm. That's probably it. And I also have more of experience with Dark Souls.
Yeah.
And I only have one experience with a raid out of the three.
Yeah.
There's Vault of Glass.
Well, I mean, including now the new one for Rise of Iron.
Wasn't that three? Machine. Well, I'm talking about all together. There's three now?
There's four now. So you have the Vault of Glass, then you have Crota's End, and then Oryx.
That's
then,
right.
Yeah, yeah.
Okay. I'm going to say Dark Souls.
Okay.
And the reason I'm going to say Dark Souls is because the difficulty in Destiny spawns from it being very cryptic.
Right.
And if you don't know what you're doing, it will take you days.
Yes.
To just figure it out.
Yes.
That's artificial difficulty. Difficulty, they need to give you the... And we've had this conversation, and I think we always disagree on this.
Yeah.
Destiny always feels like when it's the raids... They're taking things that you need to know away because they know that once you figure it out, it's easy. You can do it if you have people who are competent.
Right.
And that's another thing is like sometimes we get that one incompetent person who just makes us wipe and that adds to the difficulty.
Right.
If you remember when we played the Oryx Strike, the bosses never really killed us as much as the adds did. And we've talked about this as well, how the reason they throw ads in Destiny games is because they know that they haven't made a really good boss. Mm. And they know that everyone's going to aim at this boss and wipe him out right away.
Right.
Let's just throw in like 50 guys in there to kill him from every direction. And then people will die from those ads and go, man, this is a hard boss fight.
Right.
But it's not a hard boss fight.
Right.
The ads killed you. The boss didn't. In Bloodborne, you have all the tools that you need. You know what you need to do. If you go into Bloodborne, like Dark Souls or Bloodborne, in the final boss, and you haven't mastered certain aspects of the game, you're going to have a hard time because you need to learn all those things by then.
Yeah.
But the game gives all those things to you from the beginning. It gives you all the tools to succeed. So when you finally do succeed a boss fight, it feels amazing. With Oryx, it felt good to do it.
Mm-hmm.
For me, it mainly felt good to get it over with, because we were trying to rush it before Rise of Iron.
Right, and the Moments of Triumph.
And the Moments of Triumph. And we had did it for like 4 days straight, because we had to get different people in from like some server, from like some website or something. We had to get different people in.
Yeah.
And when we finally finished, it was with our personal friends.
Yeah, which was nice.
Which was nice. That was great. I loved that.
Yeah.
But... seeing Oryx float away was more like, I was more happy to know that the raid was finally over than to get the loot. Or
that, and narratively, it's also good to know that he's just dead.
Yes, you know? It's good to know that. But again, and I think this is just the fact that it's a multiplayer game versus a single player game.
Yeah.
And single player games, you're always going to feel rewarded because you're the one that did that.
Yeah.
Other than Destiny, where it's like, oh, the least useful person does the least amount of combat. We'll give him the job to do that requires him to do least.
Right.
And all the heavy people... we're decked out with weapons and black spindles and stuff.
Yeah.
We'll do the damage.
Right.
The other guy just has to stand there and look pretty.
Right.
And just shoot his gun and pretend like he's helping. Because I didn't have a black spindle at that point.
Yeah, yeah.
So I felt like I wasn't really helping that much. So I felt like I'm just along for the ride. Mm. That doesn't feel good. And when you win, that doesn't feel good still.
Mm.
You don't get that hype as if you
There are various mechanics that are based around the entirety of your six-person team, and like, for example, like the totems, I think that's necessary to have everyone understanding what's going on.
Yeah.
The war priest, same thing.
But again, the totems fall under cryptic.
That's true.
So...
that's true. That is very true, yeah. In terms of figuring that out, yeah. The execution is where the difficulty is, but I think in terms of figuring out where the hell, how the hell, when the hell, I absolutely agree with you, actually. I absolutely agree with you, and I think you nailed it when you said in terms of multiplayer versus single player.
Yeah.
That really just, because you can't have just sort of like a Bloodborne boss in like a multiplayer game because everyone will just shoot them.
Yeah.
And
it's hard to, and I'm not saying that, oh, Bungie is awful. They can't even do bosses right.
Right, right.
You're really limited in that because you can't, what's
the easiest way out?
What can you do? Yeah.
Yeah.
And then there's the parts where it's like, oh, well, we'll give this one enemy a really huge amount of shield, and we won't have as many ads.
No.
Then it just takes forever because the shield's taking forever to take down.
Right.
So then you lose patience because you're just getting bored unloading bullets in something.
Right.
So, yes, I do understand the ads kind of need to be in the boss fights right
yeah,
now.
Yeah, it's kind of like a balance between, like, do we want to make a bullet sponge or do we want to make, like, super heavy mechanics
or
that are
have,
so cryptic?
Do we want to have something kind of a lot of fun going around?
Yeah.
Because it's still entertaining to, like, when we're fighting off bosses and ads come in and you just pull out a hand cannon and just get headshots really
yeah,
quick.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
It still feels good.
Right.
But in terms of adding to difficulty, it's more cosmetic difficulty.
And you know what? I think they've started improving mechanically, because if you look at the Rise of Iron Strikes, for example, this is a bit of a digression, obviously, but if you look at, for example, the, what was that one? The Wretched Eye. The one where you have the giant fallen
yes.
priest that yeah. takes the
and
eye
it,
of
it,
the
like,
ogre.
Not a lot of enemies spawn there, but
few
not a lot. Yeah, yeah, very few. That's like the least amount of enemies that spawn in a boss.
Yeah.
The other one that's nice, though, is the Siva Corps would be a cool one if they would just lessen
yeah.
the enemies down
yeah.
and
yeah.
say, okay, now he's shielded, but he goes away, and now and he's obviously limited to the space that he's in,
yeah.
but now we're going to send a lieutenant in there who can chase you down,
yeah.
and you have to kill him and get his weapon to shoot at
not
the
only
Siva
that,
Corps.
But just
that
to...
would be cooler, I think, other than just saying, here's a bunch of enemies, find the one with the cannon, and then take them out.
Yeah.
I would have much more appreciated the approach of here's a strong guy. Siva Corps is going to go hang out for a bit.
Yeah.
And this guy's going to chase you down.
Yeah, I think, and you know what, in all seriousness, though, in terms of, like, how much the Sepix needed to just not be in the game because it was just fluff.
Yes.
In year one, Sepix, the definition of a bullet sponge.
And also,
it was just
shoot
him.
He was in the strike for the beta. Like, that
was
the
yeah.
only strike you could get for a beta.
Yeah.
So by the time you get to him in the actual game, you're like, I'm done with you already.
Yeah. Yeah, he needed an update big time, and he needed to actually be legitimately difficult in terms of how you kill him. I think another one that's kind of okay, but not in terms of, like, the culmination in the end is, what's it called? I think it's called Winter's End, if I'm not mistaken. It's the one where you chase Tanix throughout his
up
ship.
Up the mountain?
Oh,
no.
Through his ship. You chase Tanix the Scarred through his ship, and then that's the, like, that's the whole strike is just like, oh, you know, he's in this room, and then he runs off, and then he's in this other room with, like, a spider tank drops down from inside the ship, and then you have to chase him to, like, the pilot room, and then that's when you take him.
I'm gonna be honest. I like that boss fight, actually.
Yeah.
And the reason I like that boss fight is because you're fighting him on a ship.
Mm-hmm.
It doesn't justify all the enemies, though. I still wish the enemies would calm down.
Yeah, yeah.
But in terms of, like, oh, we're chasing him down this hall,
mm-hmm.
and he's such a coward, we're whittling him down and he's running away.
Yeah, yeah.
And then you get him in this room, and it's a big room, and there's some enemies, like, up top with snipers,
mm-hmm.
and just like, okay, we got this, we can
yeah,
get him.
Yeah.
And then he runs away again, and then he summons a tank, and it's like... He's such a coward, he has to send a tank to try to finish us.
Yeah,
it's just
yeah.
like, oh, it's so good, just kill this tank, man.
Yeah.
So
yeah.
It feels good. But again, in my mind, it's not difficulty. It falls more on the spectrum of repetitive.
Yeah, yeah, I agree. And it culminates in really just another ad rush.
And I love Destiny, or I love it now. I hated year one, and I I dropped it year one.
Yeah.
But you got me back into it.
Yeah.
And now I'm hyped for Destiny 2, and I wouldn't be playing it if it wasn't
yeah.
for my love for the game.
Yeah.
Because I have a lot of games to finish, and I finished Destiny.
Mm.
So it should be on the shelf for right now while I finish all these other games.
But it's not.
But every time you text, every single time you text me, hey, Senya and I are getting into... Destiny.
Exactly.
I'm just like, I'm there.
No, yeah. It
Even
has,
if we have nothing planned, I'm there.
It has a lure to it that is just simply great. Because in terms of that, I think that's a completely separate who wore it better in of
yes.
itself. It's just like, because Dark Souls, once you beat Dark Souls, are you going to really go back and just be, I mean, unless you're really
yes.
doing New Game Plus.
Yes, I went through Dark Souls multiple times. I've been through Bloodborne like 11 times.
I'm not kidding. I think that's subjective though at that point.
Yes.
Because a lot of people are not
absolutely.
Willing to endure
that. Oh no, absolutely. I know that's subjective.
Yeah.
I know that's not every single person who picks up, but I'm talking about me personally.
Yeah.
I have played Bloodborne over and over and over again. Same with, there's just these few games, I don't know what it is about them. Like, Deus Ex Mankind, not Mankind Divided, Human Revolution.
Yeah.
When that came out and I got it on 360, that's all I played, and I just kept going back to it and back to it and back to it, no matter what.
There are those
I knew where everything was, I like 100%ed it and everything, it was great.
Yeah.
And there are just these small amount of games that could pull me back, and it makes me think about them.
Yeah, yeah. Well, I think that was an excellent discussion on all points.
I think this turned out much better than I was expecting. I was very afraid of this.
For a first episode, I think we nailed what we want to do, and I'm kind of more excited to film the next podcast now, just on this basis alone. Mind you, the next podcast won't be in the format of Who Wore It Better, I think, at least. I think we'll save the next one for, like, maybe the one
for
after.
For a legit podcast. And the next the podcast won't be out next week.
Yeah.
Next week will be, hopefully, a video like our other two. Not really a theory video, but it's something... more of a... talking to the audience.
Sure, yeah.
Type of thing.
Yeah, no, I think, we've got something, going here in terms of schedule, so you should expect that. Expect pretty consistent stream of content. We don't have a set day, and I think that we should clarify this. We don't have a set day in terms of when we're going to post, but it's trying to do weekly.
We're trying to do weekly, or at the very latest, bi-weekly, like this one.
Right.
We don't want to be a channel that releases once a month, mainly because the videos we do, they're not super technical.
Yeah.
So it really shouldn't justify a once a month pause.
Oh, absolutely. You know, and they're simple ideas too. Yes. You know, they're not anything intricate. But yeah. So I think just so that you guys know the roadmap for you know what's to come and whatnot. We have a whole lot more planned for Sarcasmus in terms of what we intend to do. It's not just going to be theories. So far, that's what it's been. And we've tried to put as much work into those as we can.
And so far, they have been Nintendo.
Sure.
Themed.
Yeah, yeah.
We love Nintendo, but our channel is not a Nintendo theme.
Right.
There is going to be some Nintendo stuff down the line, mainly because of the Switch.
The relevance of the Switch.
The relevance of the Switch and how hype that all is.
Right, right.
But down the line, we'll be getting more into Sony, Microsoft, and PC stuff. But we're never going to drop Nintendo content.
Oh, absolutely.
We're always going to keep that because we love it.
Oh, yeah. Nintendo holds a special place in our hearts. So if it seems like we kind of glorify them sometimes, our apologies, but we're incredibly biased. But in terms of content-wise, you can expect more in broader horizons, I think. But yeah, so thanks for watching, you guys. Thanks for listening, I guess.
Yeah,
I should
thank
say.
You very much. And if you have any ideas for videos that you want to see or have talked about, please let us know.
Absolutely. Especially on the theory front, because we love a nice constant stream of theories to discuss amongst each other.
Yeah, we eat theories for breakfast.
Absolutely. All right, everybody, thanks for watching. We'll see you in the next one. Bye. Thank you.